Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Becoming Dangerous, Witchy Femmes, Queer Conjurers, and Magical Rebels. Edited by Katie West and Jasmine Elliott. Foreword by Kristen J. Soleil. Narrated by Rebecca Mitchell. Foreword. If the broom fits, witch, it is time to ride it. Act up. Resist. The Yerba Mala Collective. What does it mean to resist, when resist is the slogan of a multi-billion dollar political machine, when hashtag resist is a viral meme, when resist is printed on shirts and hats and stickers you get for joining the right email list, and resistance has been co-opted by the very systems you're trying to resist? In Becoming Dangerous, Witchy Femmes, Queer Conjurers, and Magical Rebels offer answers. Through 21 wildly different essays, the authors lay bare their prismatic perspectives on what it means to challenge the social, political, and cultural forces that seek to marginalize and erase them. Rituals of reclamation, aesthetic spellcraft, tapping into the earth for answers, cracking open your ancestral powers. These are their routes to redemption, the way these writers summon the strength to resist. Now more than ever, witches, occultists, and magicians are joining the magical resistance, healing circles for survivors, mass hexes against fascists and abusers, and collective protection spells are proliferating. The pervasive notion that the political and spiritual are contradictory is slowly being dispelled. When I started teaching my college course, The Legacy of the Witch, at the New School 5 years ago, incorporating social justice into discussions about witchcraft seemed novel to the students taking the class. Fascinating, yes, but removed from reality, they'd say. They perceived the political realm as devoid of grace and magic. They understood witchcraft to be all aesthetic and no action. But every year since then, as the American government has doubled down on exclusionary, punitive, and oppressive policies, my students arrive more and more primed to view the necessity of studying the two in tandem. Many even come to the table well-versed in both subjects, already part of magical communities, putting on their own protests and using ritual as intimate parts of their own acts of resistance. When studying witchcraft and social justice movements of the past and present, cyclical patterns emerge. As a fraught political climate simmers and comes to a roil, the occult is often the next mode of defense, of reproach. This holds today as much as it did in the age of second-wave feminism and neo-paganism, and in the time of suffragists and spiritualism. Historically, many of the greatest acts of resistance have been informed by spiritual practice, and some of the most nourishing spiritual practices have been born within society's stifling political strictures, like so many buds finally bursting through fallow soil. In 1843, Isabella Bomfrey received an otherworldly call to serve. She christened herself Sojourner Truth. She traversed the country to share and teach and extemporize about womanhood and inequity and the painful realities of racism and sexism that were tearing America apart. Truth, a former slave, was a devout Christian. By today's standards, she was so much more. Historian Nell Irvin Painter argues that Truth's syncretic spiritual practice, a mix of West African animistic beliefs, American folk magic, and Dutch Calvinism and Methodism, makes her a witch in the contemporary sense of the word. Her rituals were public, massive, and mesmeric, drawing hundreds hypnotized by her impassioned oratory as she planted the seeds that would later bloom into womanism and intersectionality. In 1974, a community of lesbians in Wolf Creek, Oregon, birthed Woman Spirit, the first quarterly magazine dedicated to both spirituality and feminism. In the midst of the women's liberation movement, these women were frustrated with the limitations of patriarchal religion, but didn't want to eschew spirituality altogether. They took the formation of consciousness-raising groups that were central to early feminism and saw the magic inherent within such sharing circles. "Feminism tells us to trust ourselves," wrote Jean Mountain Grove, one of the founders of Woman Spirit. "We began to trust our own feelings. We began to believe in our own orgasms. These were the first things. Now we are beginning to have spiritual experiences, and for the first time in thousands of years, we trust it." In 2017, an anonymous group of anti-fascist witches joined together to hex the white supremacist capitalist heteropatriarchy. Under the Yerba Mala Collective moniker, this amorphous cadre of activists released free, downloadable zines and spellbooks decrying racism, sexism, transphobia, Islamophobia, and above all, complacency. "Complacency is anti-magic," one poem of theirs declares. "Witches of all genders, ride now." The Yerba Mala Collective is a purposefully porous group of witches so numerous, you might as well call us the stars, a member told Janice Kopstein in an interview published on Medium. "We are everywhere, behind every fascist, waiting for the fist to be our own. We started as a conversation between friends, which spread to other friends around the country. We coven together in the encrypted byways of the internet to form our first response and rally cry. We are claiming our righteous anger and using that, too, as a fuel. This fight will take so much away from us. It's important we remember who we are. Divine beings with divine power." This divinity, not granted by outside forces, but cultivated and claimed internally, is palpably present in Becoming Dangerous. Through healing rituals of logomancy, the authors of this spellbinding anthology write their realities into existence, revealing how fallible flesh can become armor and why fighting to live life on your own terms is sacred. Each chapter can act as a response to the contemporary question of survival and resistance, what it means to actively counter narratives and structures that seek to oppress and keep us from not only surviving but thriving under patriarchy, white supremacy, late capitalism, and the searing traumas attendant to all three. "In truth, my rituals, the same ones I use to perform my undangerous and thoroughly human body, are weapons," writes J.A. Mike Lean in Ritualizing My Humanity. "In unabashedly affirming my own dignity, I am becoming dangerous." The witchy femmes, queer conjurers, and magical rebels in this volume know there is nothing more dangerous than the self-possessed, those who know power lies in their ability to channel and harness and subvert the tools at their disposal, those who alchemize their pain into healing and beauty, overcoming and community. They remind us that there is no one way to resist, only that it is imperative we do. Kristen J. Soleil, author of Witches, Sluts, Feminists. Introduction. The difference between the witch and the layperson is that a witch already knows they are powerful. The layperson may only suspect. To tap into this power, a witch performs rituals with purpose, with intent, and with an enviable aesthetic. Some people say witches are irrational, absurd, or ridiculous. But in response, witches smile knowingly. They see the irony in the accusations. Rituals have been and continue to be performed in all societies throughout time, to such an extent that the performance of ritual could be said to be the defining characteristic of human beings. What are we if not the culmination of our efforts to construct meaning where there is none, to pull reason from the absurd? Currently, the world is very similar in look and feel to a dumpster on fire. It's been this way for a while, so we keep trying to come up with ways to make it better, or easier, or kinder. But as of yet, nothing has really worked. Not fighting for it, dying for it, praying for it, working for it, or wishing for it. As a result, we feel powerless. In response to this failure, many have resorted to coming up with ways to explain it, to look at the world around them and see it as normal. this is fine. This book is full of the ways in which queer conjurers, witchy femmes, magical rebels, and people like you, or maybe nothing like you, resist the onslaught of a world of irrational happenings and the normalization of their world on fire. It offers personal explorations from the authors of how they've created their own irrational actions that give them the strength, patience, community, and hope required to survive. These arbitrary activities are their rituals, and this book tells us how and why they work for them. What makes these arbitrary actions into rituals is the intention behind them. Witches already know this. So do religions. They know that rituals don't mean anything on their own, separate from any context. It's the intention that makes a series of arbitrary actions powerful. But unlike religious rituals, which are prescribed by someone else and must be performed in a certain way, the rituals we discover and create for ourselves, like the ones described by the authors in this book, can grow out of our own bodies, spirits, and desires. The act of deliberately choosing to apply significance to our actions and to cultivate a deeper meaning to them is powerful. We can use ritual to gain control, and not just any kind of control, a specific type of control that requires no one else's approval or permission. It is completely self-wrought, and that makes it incredibly powerful. Becoming Dangerous is a book about using ritual to resist. When so many forces outside ourselves are trying to take away our rights, freedoms, and agency, adhering to practices that center us as fully realized people, dependent on and owing only to the earth, those we love, and the development of ourselves, instead of to elected officials or systems of oppression and those who uphold them, can't be a bad idea. There is a power disparity in our world. Those with power are not keen on sharing, and those of us without are left with discovering ways to summon it for ourselves. Discovering power that hasn't been given to us begrudgingly or allocated sparingly makes us threatening. Power makes us dangerous. I sent a draft of this introduction to my friend Kara Ellison, the first author in this book, actually, and I told her I just wanted to answer the question, why did I make a book about rituals? And Kara replied instantly, because everything else hasn't worked. Oh, right. Yes, that. That is why I made a book about rituals. This world is hard and unreasonable, and there's those within it who would prefer you to be powerless. But I see you. I know you're tired. I know the world is a hard place to navigate, and you are right to have hoped it would have been, if not easier, at least better by now. Instead, you're left waiting for equal rights, for gender to be recognized as a spectrum, for reconciliation, for self-acceptance, for the right to choose, for the patriarchy to burn, for universal health care, for access, for it not to be audacious to demand decency and kindness. I see you, and I'm glad you're still here, still struggling, resisting, fighting, yearning for all the above and more. And I want you to know, like so many witches already know, that you're powerful. Find your rituals. Find your power. Find your reason. Become dangerous. Katie West, editor, Becoming Dangerous, Edinburgh, January 2018. Notes from the editors regarding the print and ebook. Having a style guide for a book makes it an easier read. Inconsistent expressions of punctuation, spellings, or other grammatical rules can pull the reader out of a narrative. However, at times, while editing Becoming Dangerous, we've made exceptions or changes to our guide in order to respect the authors, their preferences, and their practices. Some words have various spellings used throughout the book. For example, magic is also expressed as M-A-G-I-C-K, and this has been a conscious choice by each author. Another example is the capitalization of moon. Several authors prefer this spelling, as it reflects the importance of the moon in their practice. There is also a pronoun in Catherine Hernandez's essay, There. That is how her lover refers to themselves. In regards to spellings of groups of people, we've followed the rule of always go with what those people are calling themselves. The word indigenous has been capitalized when speaking about indigenous people in Canada. When referring to indigenous cultures of other regions, it has been left lowercase or to the discretion of the author. The word non-binary has been expressed without the hyphen in most cases, subject to the author's preference. And our reasoning for doing so is that hyphens are often used when something new enters the English language with the help of a prefix. Once that word has been around for a while and is accepted into normal usage, it often loses the hyphen. We felt expressing it without a hyphen shows, in language, an acceptance and embracing of non-binary people. However, we recognize that, as Miranda Elizabeth, who feels the word non-binary may currently be more accepted in language but not in concept and understanding of lived experience, graciously explained to us, having to identify with words that describe what people are not, non-binary, genderless, rather than what they are, isn't ideal. We've tried to do the best we can with the language currently available to us. Katie West and Jasmine Elliott, editors, Becoming Dangerous. Content warnings. This book has 21 essays covering a vast range of topics from a deep pool of personal experience, from boxing to gardening, from dealing with post-traumatic stress disorder to dealing with racism, from nail extensions to slut magic. We want all our listeners to be able to enjoy the experience of going through this book, so we're including a list of content or trigger warnings for each essay in this anthology. Our goal at Fiction and Feeling is to elevate underrepresented voices and topics, which can mean that some listeners are engaging with topics, experiences, and viewpoints for the first time and may find this strange or uncomfortable. Other listeners may find certain topics more difficult to deal with than others. The content of an essay may bring up painful memories or trigger panic attacks. Many topics could potentially be the trigger for such reactions, though there are some main culprits, such as abuse, self-harm, violence, blood, war, rape, and eating disorders. Including a content warning at the beginning of a piece of writing that gives a quick description of what can be expected can act as a heads-up for those who need it. Content warnings are not meant to suggest a listener stays away from a piece of writing. Rather, they hopefully give a reader some time to prepare themselves for what they're about to encounter. This can be true for either subjects that might cause physical and emotional distress, or themes that might be uncomfortable and challenging. Content warnings. Trash magic, signs and rituals for the unwanted. Discussions of poverty, ableism, suicide, borderline personality disorder. Uncensoring my ugliness. Discussions of violence, serious injury, descriptions of medical procedures. Femme as in fuck you. Fucking with the patriarchy one lipstick application at a time. Discussions of sexual assault, racism, colonialism. Before I was a woman, I was a witch. Discussions of bullying, suicide, gender dysphoria. Undressing my heart. Discussions of war, sex. Garden. Discussions of excrement, death, grief. Reddit, Retin A, and Resistance, an alchemist's guide to skincare. Discussions of depression. My witch's Sabbath of short skirts, long kisses, and BDSM. Discussions of sex, religion. The harpy. Explicit discussions of rape, abuse, self-injury, dissociation, PTSD. Fingertips. Discussions of body dysmorphic disorder. Red glitter. Discussions of sex, non-blood bodily fluids. touching pennies, painting nails, discussions of religion, ritual in darkness, discussions of sex, explicit scenes of war, Gayuma, discussions of oppressive political regimes, child abuse, rape, pushing beauty up through the cracks, discussions of colonialism, war, ritualizing my humanity, discussions of racism, simulating control, discussions of PTSD, Unfuckable, Kara Ellison. Scotland is unfuckable. Scotland cannot, will not be fucked. It has always been, and to this day is, in a total and complete lack of having been fucked, fucked up, fucked over, fucked with. I say this in defiance of a history of its misery and domination, poverty and neglect. Though it has been bought and sold, and barely any of its land is owned by anyone who really lives there. For certain, Scotland has been fucked on. Robert Burns and Edwin Morgan wrote down in beautiful detail the desiring of a woman's and man's body, respectively. But the way that the accepted canon of literary men talks about land, ownership, territory, Scotland is unfuckable because it is inhospitable. I am become the land I stand on. I cannot remember exactly when the transformation took place, but I would like to tell you about where I realized it had and the powerful ritual it gave me. It is the grand masculine colonial tradition to talk about women as if they were a conquerable landscape, from Sir Walter Raleigh's naming of Virginia after a virgin queen, through the way that residents of the Kingdom of Fife adoringly called the Lowland Hills the Paps of Fife, or the Breasts of Fife. In the pale teal mornings, I would lie back on my grandmother's cold garden lawn and compare my growing chest bumps to the horizon. But as I look closer at the history of Scotland, that very early history before and enduring the ancient Romans, I learn that, in the beginning, women were never the tilled, the claimed, the fertile land that the romantic poets made them. They were wild. The crags, the bursting river, the unpredictable, the dangerous, those who may at any point take it all away. We might one day lash the world like a cat surprised, break the skin of natural order, and have the contents below burst into mess. It was that part of the land metaphor we occupied. We were not known as the passive, but the prickly, the spiky, the terrifying, the vicious. Scotland did not behave. Scotland will not behave. As Sharon Blackie writes in her book, If Women Rose Rooted, Celtic women had social standing that most other contemporaries in the West did not, and Christianity came to change that for the worse. In Ireland and Britain, women could be leaders and were important in political, social, and religious roles. Boudica and Cardamandua, for example, led their people into battle, and Celtic women have been reported to have been judges, priestesses, lawyers, astronomers, artists, and doctors, often with rights to property, sexual freedom, and recourse to damages if they were physically or sexually assaulted. A Celtic woman was feared and respected. The Romans are on record saying, "You do not fuck with a Celtic woman." The whole Celtic world was based on the ordaining of place, of the natural world. What we might now call the femme was indivisible from the land on which people lived. This land was not something considered to belong to anyone. I leaf through the Ulster cycle of Irish literary tradition, a sort of Marvel universe of the Dark Ages, the stories Celts constructed together as they cooked and drank and wove and washed and stole each other's sheep. One figure in particular stands out to me, Scaddach, a famous warrior woman and prophet who lived with her daughter on the Isle of Skye. Scaddach taught the Irish heroes how to snatch life from one another and vault ramparts like giants, like gods. There is little centered upon her alone, but she has an easy traversal through the background of stories written down about more famous Irish heroes. She stands, smiling, to the side of gilt Celtic knot lettering, behind the posturing of hundreds of words of male-ingratiated prose. She gets up every morning to sharpen spears, kick the shins of young Irishmen, wash blood out of undershirts. Her daughter is on the wall watching her, sewing and spotting selkies in the ocean waves. There is supposed to be failure in a woman being alone. For years it bothered me that I was not possessed by another or attached in some way. What are you supposed to do with yourself when the ways in which society is structured make you safe or content only if you are tied, legally or socially, to another, more esteemed gender? It is not that you cannot have it. There are many men who would marry you, or would at least treat you kindly. It is that happiness and a steady attention supply are not the same thing. Happiness and a steady attention supply are not the same thing. They are not even related. And the only reason that I thought they were was because very many of my role models were operating under the same delusion. That you might think they are the same thing is because of magazines, social media, romantic movies, people's fickle approval, the way people talk about weddings and marriage. He'll make you happy. Those are mythology. The only things needed for happiness are a fixed abode, safety, food, water, care, and stories. The care and stories can come from anyone, romantic or otherwise. You do not need daily attention to survive. You merely only need to experience daily care. The care, if it is not forthcoming, can be sought most of the time. But it must be face-to-face, in person. And the greatest purveyors of it these days tend not to be men. 2 years ago, I stopped being subject to the woodpecker opinions of the internet, stopped reassessing my worth by the comments column, deleted my popular Twitter account, and wandered into the constant dark wilderness of my home country, far away from the cities that require that you sell yourself to keep from suffocating. There, I began to write what I wanted at length in private and work at jobs that required my physical presence. I found people nearby who cared for me, and I cared for. I found people who wanted to tell stories with me. This has brought me close to my motherland in a way that I have never been. I have become firm friends with the roiling dark and gray-blue frowns of the unpredictable. In fact, I revel in downpours and thunder and fierce ripping winds. And when they catch me by surprise, I like to linger in and try to prolong them. I try to think of all the women who knew how to thatch a roof and butcher a pig and find a spring, those who may not have had care like I can have care. Atop my neighbor, Calton Hill, men have placed enlightenment monuments that poke the sky. But when it rains, the clouds envelop and sap their power. Beneath the hill, it is said, the pale queen sits ready to impart to local women the gifts of how to survive. Perhaps I have finally listened. Perth Railway Station is a Victorian building made of red and white brick triangles and inverted U-shapes. If you grew up in the United Kingdom, there's a good chance you think Perth Railway Station looks a bit like a 70s Safeway supermarket. There's nothing particularly mysterious or interesting about its iron girders if what you are seeking is a reclusive martial artist from a Dark Ages tome. Striding out towards the car park, where multicolored pansies sit in troughs, I remember an urban childhood spent in and out of Perth and Aberdeen on the east coast of Scotland, only sometimes broken by trips to Balloch, Benicay, Glenshey. Sometimes I'd see my aunt in Auchtermuchty, something that, in proper Scots pronunciation, sounds a lot like coughing twice or a compound sneeze, a place that looks like a village from Outlander. We won't be needing postcard images where we're going. Remove all thoughts of tweed Jacobite sex fantasies and Highland toffee trim and the comfort of train spottings nearby Class A drugs. My mind can't get past the sadness and massacre, old stains of poverty and airborne seafoam that will be at our destination, possible guesthouse fish and chips if we are lucky. We are going to Dune Scothic, a ruin named Fortress of Shadows in Gaelic, like it might be some sort of Dark Souls level. And I know from 32 years' experience there is nothing cute about the ankle-spraining hikes of Caledonian coastal cliffs, and treating them like a lovely little jolly into Highland cow territory is what the Isle of Skye frankly wants from you before it opens up rock pool jaws and consumes you whole. My friend Kat, whose expertise in both driving and photography I have hired for the weekend, shows me her supplies in the back of the car. Welly boots, waterproof trousers, windbreakers, fleeces, possible armor for an oncoming storm. Photographers never leave anything to chance. There's a lot of expensive equipment to abandon in a sucking bog. We look at the weather forecast. As usual, the answer comes, changeable. The Isle of Skye is more than 5 hours' drive away to the northwest, but not on flat, wide straits. After you leave Fort William for the islands, it is a shoulder wrench on the steering column around steep hills, up and down narrow roads populated with spiteful sheep, the force of the usual angry cloudburst and gale-force winds making it likely you will drive into a springy heather trap ditch. If you consider Scotland an old woman's face turned west towards North America, as my Highland ancestors did, then we are driving to the edge of her bushy eyebrow to try to understand what she is thinking. In the car, I try not to think about Skadic, but she is all I can think about. Skadic, the warrior woman's largest role, happens in an old Irish Gaelic tale called The Wooing of Emer. In the earliest form of the tale, the Ulster hero, Cú Chulainn, has to prove himself to the father of his prospective bride, Emer. Part of the father's approval depends on Cú Chulainn going to Scotland to train with a great martial artist, Har Skadic, who resides in a place called the Fortress of Shadows. It is such a demanding regime that it is expected that Cú Chulainn will die in training. In fact, Emer's father is counting on it. The Fortress of Shadows has a long precipice to negotiate at a solid door at the entrance. Cú Chulainn walks across the precipice and stabs his spear right through the door of the dun, or fortress. Skadic's daughter Wathic opens the door, presumably to find out who is damaging the door. No daughter of Skadic fears mere violence. Wathic is immediately dumbstruck by how agonizingly hot Cú Chulainn is. I believe the translation in the Review Celtic states, "She did not speak to him, so much did his shape move her desire." Wathic goes upstairs to tell her mother Skadic about him. I like to imagine he looks like hot Chris Pratt. Maybe Chris Pratt in The Magnificent Seven, or in that Jurassic Park movie where he seduces a pack of velociraptors. I ruminate from time to time on the conversation that supposedly passed between the two women about Cú Chulainn. Skadic is a very famous teacher of the fuck-em-up arts, and she runs what one might consider a sprawling martial arts training ground, the kind you might see in a Bruce Lee movie. Only they're all Scottish and Irish, and they really like swords and haft weapons. Skadic's by no means a stupid woman, and she's a woman who's used to huge, strapping Irish heroes turning up at her door, or at least dying on the precipice before it for her entertainment. There's no direct speech suggested for what Wathic says to her about Cú Chulainn, but it's probably something like, "Mum, there's an Irish hero at the door, and he's so hot my eyes and crotch might have gone on fire." Skadic's reply is something like, "Put him in my bed then. I've been bored all this time." It is this ability to be completely unimpressed with the world that made Skadic immediately dear to me. Generally speaking, Cú Chulainn is one of the worst house guests you could possibly imagine. When he was young, he killed his host Hullen's guard dog and had to pretend to be a guard dog for Chulainn until a replacement dog was reared, which is how Cú Chulainn got his name. At Skadic's house, he accidentally breaks Wathic's finger, and then kills one of Skadic's guest champions. Kuhalan also goes out to try to slay Aoife, a neighboring warrior woman said to be the best in the world, against Skadic's will, and brings her back as prisoner. I imagine Skadic's carpets, if there are any, are ruined. Do not have Kuhalan round your house. He will do something awful. And yet, Skadic seems to care about Kuhalan, probably because her daughter ends up betrothed to him. I'm not really versed in Irish marriage laws, but doesn't he want to marry Emmer? Doesn't this cause some problems? Should it? How many children is this guy supposed to have? Didn't he swear a vow of chastity to Emmer that was immediately violated when he met Skadic? So many questions for the editor. But she's not even ruffled by his behavior. When he kills a visiting champion, she's just like, "That is inconvenient. What are you going to do about that?" It seems that, to Skadic, the whole world is just teeming with impetuous young Irish imbeciles who run rampant across the land like kittens might play all over their bored, slightly sleepy mother. It's this quality that I like about her. She's the best at what she does because she's seen it all. Skadic is only scared of Aoife, her neighbor, but Skadic lives in a fortress with all the heroes of the Celtic world. What has she got to worry about, really? She knows all of the secrets of the art of killing others. That's why men come to her. The 5-hour drive to Fort William feels like being in the first season of True Detective, the passing landscape like some ticking time bomb, and the serial killer is the weather. The sky quickly blows past gray clouds and covers us in fine mist, then solid rain, then mist again. Most of Scotland's motorways pass by fields of cows or sheep or horses, pine trees, telephone poles, giant mountains, heather and heather and heather, cottages, squat gray villages, and sometimes a couple petrol stations. Cat, a seasoned Highlands driver, has planned to stop at the Fort William Morrison supermarket to get lunch and a break from looking at the road's white Morse code before she stick shifts around winding single-track roads. The hard part. The difficult part. The part where you might fuck it up entirely. We have been mostly silent. Kat and I don't know each other well, but we are happy in each other's company. Anticipation feels like a person sitting dourly, dark-browed in the back, like a murderer of hopes and dreams. Probably we are both wondering what might go wrong, or trying to think about what we might see from that coast. We are definitely thinking about the weather and how it will piss it down the closer we get. We are both thinking about where we will sleep and what we will eat. The further you get to the edge of the Roman Empire in Britain, the less comfortable everything gets. They used to build us roads, you know. Straight roads Britons still use. But the Romans were not used to the watery based army Scotland kept in the sky, and they didn't care to face the land army either. I'm telling you this because ancient history has had a direct effect on Scotland and how it works. Inverness, Edinburgh, Glasgow, Aberdeen, we all have what anyone in the United States has in terms of, well, stuff. But sometimes there are places that even Amazon won't go. It doesn't make fiscal sense. The ancient Romans worked this out early. Probably the Romans built the wall against us because they disliked the idea of fighting men and women hardened on the absence of tiled, heated floors and steam rooms, and whose primary idea of intimacy was telling each other the most heart-wrenching stories they could think of, then dueling each other to the death over them. If you have ever wanted to live in a society entirely made of warrior poets, this is the logical endpoint of one. I always think about a game the Roman soldiers used to play when they kept watch on the ramparts of Vindolanda at Hadrian's Wall. They would throw a red ball over the wall into Scotland, and every soldier would try to throw their ball closest to it. The closest ball to the red ball would win. The ball furthest away from the red ball would lose. The owner would be lowered into Scotland to pick all the balls up. I laugh to myself every time at the idea of a Roman soldier in full leather armor regalia and winter fur running about the bushes, frantic, before the Scots arrive to pick him off. Probably this was the main entertainment of the game for the not-losers, like ancient Roman Takeshi's castle. Only if you fell, a Scot jumped out and stabbed you. Kat and I sit in the cafe of Morrison's over mugs of lukewarm brown coffee, with that thin layer of milk fat glinting on the top of it, looking out past the last vestiges of what one might call urban life on our way. Next to us are the bright yellow arches of a McDonald's restaurant, strangely not that far from the actual Clan McDonald outposts. Scots like to brag about what we gave the world, but sometimes it bites us in the arse. We're going to Lord of the Isles territory. If these terms seem familiar, George R.R. Martin has probably borrowed them. The Galloglass came from these islands. They were a breed of Viking that settled with the Gaels as early as the mid-13th century and became so good at fucking people up that the Irish, the French, and even the English hired them as mercenaries for their own private battles. People were scared of them. They were in awe of them. They carried a Sparthax, a long haft weapon with an axe blade that often curved around to meet the pole it sat on, and a broadsword or claymore, Scots for very large sword. If you faced them, they did not have to be very close to you to put a lot of metal through you like butter. Alongside, they would bring two boys, like squires, to hold other implements of war, throwing spears for those pesky ones who run away, and a snack, for after the spear has landed in the enemy's back. Was the character of Scottic based on these terrifying mercenaries? The more bleak purple mountains we encounter on the drive towards her reputed fortress, the more real she becomes to me. The more the rain threatens to bash through the windscreen, the more I think I know how she thinks. The closer we get to a place named after her, the less fictional she becomes. My day job is to write stories, to make people up. Being the creator of a story world is difficult because one particular question sits on the shoulders all day. Are you imitating the world or shaping it? Is this something that must correspond to your own experience, or can you write what you imagine, what you wish something to be, what should be? If you are writing something down, are you responsible for what it does to people? Are you responsible for the reaction when it hits someone? How responsible? Scotland is covered in these anxious questions. The central rail station in Edinburgh is called Waverley, after Sir Walter Scott's novels about a village of the same name. The place name Waverley was made up for the book. But now it is a place. It is a real place in lowland Scotland. And Sir Walter Scott is responsible for imagining it, and by his influence, he made it. By writing it down, he asked for it to come into being. People believed Waverley should exist so much that it now exists. Shakespeare made up places in Verona that now exist. Juliet's tomb is a sarcophagus you may visit in Verona with no one buried in it. Shakespeare had never been to Verona. And so, if you invent a warrior woman of the Galloglass ilk and place her in the wilderness of sky in a place called the Fortress of Shadows, will she eventually arrive? How much of this was based on a real person or a real idea? Was it based on a real place? Did it come into being because people believed it into being? Or did someone build a castle, name it after her, and claim that it was once hers? I can't find any historical records to explain it, and it's unlikely there is anything much that has survived. What came first? Did she come first, or did the land? Did the stories come first, or did some role model, some leader? She was never real. But then, when you look out of your car window at the gathering storm, when you are winding round and round past angry sheep with those eyes like the insides of razor blades, you think, there must have been some basis, in fact. There must have been someone. We arrive at Dunscadic, the 15th century castle named after Scadic, said, by local legend, to be built on the foundations of Scadic's fortress itself. It is battering rain. We get out of the car at the edge of Skye's coast and look over an unruly field of sheep towards a small hump on the horizon. The air in the remote parts of Scotland is sharp and fresh, always so full of petrichor and the taste of wild green leaves. Sometimes breathing it feels like drinking iced water on a hot day. We trudge through springy, soggy peat bog and up over hills until it winds into view, a gray mouth crouching on a small mound, gnarled, snarling. "That's it?" I say to Cat, holding my waterproof's hood over my glasses. "That's it? We found it." There's a weird feeling in the bottom of my stomach. Pounded by waves over the years, it has no walls, but the foundations and what look like steps are still visible on the other side, overgrown with grass and some sort of vegetation in the middle, up by where the ground floor of the hall used to be. "Do you think we can get in?" Kat asks. "I don't know. We have to get closer." We trudge towards it as the rain spatters into our eyes. Horizontal rain blinds us as we arrive at a square hole. "There's no drawbridge," I say. This is a stupid statement, because of course there isn't. Instead, there is a huge, gaping drop onto rocks below that look like jagged teeth. A thin line of slidey stones reach across it at either side, where the drawbridge once rested when it was down. "Can you get across?" Kat says. I test a stone underneath my green wellies. The wellies are massive, and they don't have very good grip. In good weather, a careful and dainty explorer might be able to edge across one of the drawbridge supports and into the castle itself. But today, I'm certain trying to do this in the rain will result in my smashed corpse in the rocky moat below. I lay awake that night in a cheap hotel bed and think about the stories of Scadic. Even if Dunscadic was opportunistically named after Scadic in order to maximize its fearsome reputation, I wonder if, in some manner, the actual act of believing that a fictional figure might have lived there gives her a better chance of slipping into existence. It's a well-known story Scottish grandmothers tell that sometimes, where the forest has a cold spot, that is a thin place, a place where the boundary between this world and the other world of spirits, fairies, and pixies is worn. I wonder if thin place magic has somehow worked its stuff on the castle, and that weird feeling I have around it is just excess belief turning into the real. When I was young, I was particularly enamored with the Terry Pratchett book Hogfather, a comedic fantasy book about a parallel medieval world to ours, where a man analogous to Father Christmas goes missing, and Death himself has to take over the job. In the book, Pratchett describes a world in which strong belief in a particular mythical figure can pop that figure into existence. The Tooth Fairy, for example, starts to exist in a physical form simply because enough children believe in her. I always think about this book as a powerful reminder that perhaps it doesn't even matter that the Tooth Fairy does not exist. Sometimes pretending that something exists, even as a symbol, is necessary, so that losing a tooth might seem like a less gruesome or painful experience. Doesn't all fiction function this way? The next day, I run full pelt towards Dunscadic for the second time. Cat has parked and left me alone. It is drier now, but the wind is up. My hair whirls around me. The springy moss rises up to meet my Doc Martens. I put Grimes up very loud in my headphones and look searchingly at the looming gray walls as they near. It is the last chance I will have to really find her. I have an hour until the rain comes and makes my task impossible. I'll do it, I think. This time, I'll do it. In the stories, Irish heroes have to make it through a number of trials and over a dangerous precipice to get to the door of the Fortress of Shadows and greet Skadic. I edge out onto the little ledge, no more than a couple of inches in width, and grab onto the remaining mortar beside it to steady myself. The grips on my Doc Martens hold me there as I look down at the drop, and my stomach flips. The wind slaps my hair on my cheek. I try to look straight out at the view of the coast instead. Stark claws, slung with striped tides of blue and green seaweed, the rocky beach curving away. Purple heather playing on the cliffs above. I take a deep breath, and, agonizing, gripping the side, I take baby steps all the way along towards the landing. I step onto the other side into a sandy pathway. Underfoot, I feel what were probably once perfectly flat flagstones, and I look up a winding staircase that leads steeply up the hill. Warriors had used these once for real. They had climbed the steps in sopping armor with food and fur and those little round shields. Suddenly, I run all the way up the winding steps, up into the castle, feeling my whole body grin. Fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, I made it! And run straight into a sea of nettles at the top, a massive lake of them surrounding me. Some childhood instinct makes me hold my hands up high to avoid the stinging barbs on the leaves, and I gasp. A laugh so loud comes out of me as I look around this final trial. Surrounded. Surrounded. A whole swath of nettles up to the waist. But I'm wearing waterproofs as armor. Skadic cannot beat me this way. I wade through the giant nettle field until I come out of the other side into the clearing where the main hall used to be. It is grassy, some foundation walls still visible in the ground. The heroes of Ulster left the carpet neat after all. Then I notice there is a small hole right in the center of the ground with very clear water in it. I scoop some into my mouth messily. Fresh. The remains of the castle well. The castle is siege-proof. At the edge of Dunskadic, the remains of the walls give way to a sheer drop into the sea below. The wind pushes at my shoulders and sucks at my elbows as I look at the waves smashing the pebbles and rocks. It is breathtakingly beautiful from here. White speckled tidal islands are little humps out in the Irish Sea. There is nothing but gray rippling waves and those roiling, rolling layers of blue-orange cloud cover. It is like looking at an animated painting where all of the rippling brushstrokes and layers are visible. I find a place on the castle edge to sit and do nothing but look at the grass carpet and stare out over the coast, watching the birds play by a cliff lip. This is what it would be like to have a castle of your own, I think. To live by yourself. To be self-sufficient. To need nothing and want nothing. To be contented. I don't fucking need you, I blurt out. I hardly hear it the first time. I realize I have said it, and then I frown at myself. Who am I talking to? What am I talking about? I don't know. It could be anyone, anything. But it seems so fitting I say it again. I don't fucking need you. I don't fucking need you. I don't fucking need you. I lose my breath, and I laugh, and it feels like everything, every weight I ever had, comes out of me. The stones and hills and sea are the only witnesses. I can't help myself. I whisper at the well in the center of the castle, as if it is in on the secret. I don't fucking need you, I say under my breath. Quietly, like it is a spell that only works on me. I don't fucking need you. I sit there silently for an hour, my mind completely blank, devoid of wanting or needing anything at all but to sit and look. I just look at Scotland and feel like I am part of it. Scotland continues. It is fine. Slowly, as the rain sweeps in, I walk down the steps of the castle, edge out over the precipice, and walk back to the car where Kat is packing up. I say, "I got inside. It had a well. It was beautiful." "I saw you sitting on the edge," she said, and I wonder if she saw me laughing. I don't know what came first, the fortress or the story. In many ways, the place is more important than the story. It is evocative of stories. When I need to be calm, I say the mantra, "I don't fucking need you." It is part of how Skadic functions in The Wooing of Emmer, and it is part of me now. When I say it, all the world's insidious systems and oppressions and dark, spirit-voiding animosity recoil from my vicinity temporarily, wash back into a yonder where they cannot hurt me. I have become like the fortress. I am the rock by the ocean, under the lashing rain, raking sun, banshee wind, shadow, hail, and that thin, consistent, spitting mist Scots call smur. And I am wild, and you cannot mark something that is so profoundly marked. To Scotland, all happenings are mere exfoliation. And I have become like Scotland, the woman who is the landscape. You cannot fuck with that kind of woman. Trash magic. Signs and rituals for the unwanted. Miranda Elizabeth. Content warning. Discussions of poverty, ableism, suicide, borderline personality disorder. "Those flowers belong to the city," somebody shouted as I retrieved a bouquet from a green dumpster on the side of a busy street, my cane resting alongside the bin so I could use both hands. I didn't look up. Whoever it was, they didn't come closer, didn't repeat themselves. I brought the flowers home and placed them on my nightstand beside a tarot deck and a desk lamp with a hot pink cord and a dim bulb. I knew the flowers were a sign. The two-drawer nightstand was found at a junk store in the tiny village where I lived in a haunted house as a baby. While revisiting the place, I picked up a piece of broken concrete from a path leading to another haunted house, this one abandoned, weeds creeping through the cracks. "Leave that house alone," somebody else yelled. Again, I didn't look, didn't respond. "I'm from here," I wanted to yell. "I belong here too." Around the corner, as I raised my phone to take a photo of my yellow brick babyhood home, a black cat trotted out from the backyard and sat on the path leading to the concrete patio my dad, a construction worker, laid shortly before our family split. She looked like she was protecting the place. She looked like she knew me, had a message for me. She looked like she belonged. One of my visualizations for getting around the city is to imagine myself, my crooked body and odd appearance, as a black cat crossing somebody's path. Good luck to some, bad luck to others. When I'm bad luck, I'm haunting, the young disabled misfit you don't want to become. I'm ugly and mysterious. I'm in pain when I'm not supposed to be. I'm the black cat dashing out in front of your car, staring you down, trespassing on your property, daring you to shoo me away. When I'm good luck, I'm really good. I'm a sign. Catching a glimpse of me feels meaningful. A witch in tourmaline and amethyst, my cane becoming my wand, a sight of another cripple goth, another disabled weirdo, in a landscape too often inaccessible to us. Sometimes we share a nod. I'm the lucky talisman you find on the ground. Keep in your pocket. I'm the black cat sitting at the feet of the Queen of Wands. I'm a spell come true. Bad luck or good, I'm magic. I make rituals for different times, different spaces. Home rituals, hospital rituals, crypt rituals, dumpster rituals, writing rituals, body rituals, rituals of celebration, of comfort, of gratitude, rituals to remain present, rituals to protect myself, rituals to feel a sense of belonging, belonging wherever I am, whether I'm at home or elsewhere, outdoors or in, always belonging in my body. Rituals of resistance, of affirmation. My mantras come from books about witchcraft, books about borderline personality disorder. They come from fiction. I make them up. Every surface in my home has become an altar. I painted my door lavender, hung up a plastic skeleton from the dollar store adorned with a filmy, dusky mauve cape, glowing eyes. A deep violet rug in the stairwell tests the parameters of my own home, making visible a hint of my personality, my magic, to those who pass through in the cobwebbed shared entrance. The door is crooked, misaligned with the frame. I burn black candles here. The building is almost 100 years old. My writing desk, another altar, found at a yard sale in my hometown for $10, spray-painted lavender, outside by the lilac bushes in the backyard of a house I lived in almost 10 years ago. Three drawers, metal handles, scratches on the surface, touched up with nail polish, purple glitter. I've written dozens of zines on this desk, several novels on this desk, so many diaries, letters, notes, to-do lists, invoices, too. There's a large chunk of amethyst on the left corner, chosen because of its shape, its odd opaque points of quartz protruding from its otherwise deep violet sharp curves, reminded me of the Three of Pentacles. I look at it when I'm writing and imagine I am inside it. I imagine this corner of my home is the same corner in the image on the tarot card, the hidden nook where my creative work is my form of prayer, my form of spellcasting, the place where I practice, where I cry, where I scribble, where I scry. For medical appointments, I book Wheeltrans rides. Wheeltrans is a service provided by the city for disabled folks who can't or who can rarely access public transit. It costs the same, $3.25. There are buses, but most of my rides are in cabs contracted by the city. I've had a lot of conversations with cab drivers, learned about their lives, seen how strangers treat them. In the back seat, window down, depending on my mood, I feel sometimes pathetic, sometimes grateful, sometimes like a sad cripple being driven to the hospital again, sometimes like a rich eccentric with a personal chauffeur. I keep my backpack, adorned with enamel pins as magical talismans, on my lap. Sometimes I tweet about my ride and attempt to demystify the process, the service, connect with other crips. A single Tylenol 3 and Xanax are the potion I imbibe before medical appointments, one for pain, the other for anxiety. I used to cry at every single appointment, for years. I still do sometimes, but less so since I decided to make art of them. Crying in public became one of my forms of resistance. In hospitals, my cane is still my wand, and my camera becomes a magical implement, too. When I hold my cane, my fist clutches the handle, but I keep my middle finger extended, another form of protection. Documenting my medical appointment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.